Somewhere just across the Jordan River, there is a place of everlasting joy and peace, where the stream of life is blowing there forever. And a crown of life is waiting there for me. That sounds like home to me, like where I want to be. There'll be no tears to fill our eyes again. As we sing of his grace and glory, where the saints of God will be, that sounds like home to me. They say there's mansions there inside that city, a crystal river flowing by the tree of life. No pain or disappointments there to hurt us. And Jesus Christ himself will be the light. That sounds like home to me, like where I want to be. There will be no tears to fill our eyes again. The hills will echo with the story as we sing of his grace and glory, where the saints of God will be. That sounds like home to me. And where the saints of God will be, that sounds like home to me.
Amen, amen. Let's try number 246 in the red book.
Shining in the light of your glory, pour out your power and love
as we sing.
Holy, 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 I am lifted up. Shining
amen. I want to see him. Amen. Good to see everybody in the house of the Lord. If you'd like turning your scriptures, turn back where we read this morning, and we'll try to have then comments and questions so you get everything ready. And just remember to pray one for another. Remember to keep praying for our wife in this time of problems with the work in that knee and things, because it's got to be done to be able to make it better for later on, you know. So it's a hard thing to do, but we thank everybody for praying and all that's been done. Amen. Hebrews 11. Now, remember the announcements. Remember the ministers' meeting will be this coming Saturday to the ministers up at Brother Bill Yount's. And then remember the fellowship meeting will be at Brother Kershane's on the 20th. So remember that and keep these in mind, you know, of these meetings and the different things. I think that's the main announcements, but just keep them, all right? Father, we thank you for your love and your grace and kindness. We thank you for everything. We know and realize that without you, there's no hopes whatsoever for any of us. We just pray that you would help us and guide us now and forgive our sins, the thoughts of our minds, and the things that we think about that are contrary to you and the things, Lord, of life that is not according to you and walking in your love and your grace. We just ask you, Father, to help us and keep us, fill us with love and understanding, forgive our sins, lead us by thy grace. Lord, just have your way in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, Hebrews 11. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it, what, by faith, the elders obtained a good report. All right? Now, but then Paul would get on over and he'd say, verse 13 of Hebrews, and what did he say? These all died in faith, having not received the promises. All right? Then he drops over to the 39th verse. He says, and all these having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. That you may be seated, the Lord add his blessing to the reading of the word. Now, I pray that this part has been at least an eye-opener to you to help you to understand and, you know, that we spent a lot of time and doings in it, but I pray that it would help you. But my point was, and this morning, you know, we had some company, different things, and so you kind of change things a little bit. But so you get ready for your comments and your questions about what we're talking about. But what has been the theme of what we've been speaking of? Is for you and I not to necessarily look back and recognize, you know, everything and see everything, and that's well and good, you know, because that's the background. But to recognize and see who we are and what we're doing here. Because our point has been what? That no one in the Bible or no one in anything has ever amounted to anything without a positive attitude. Right. You know, to be positive about it. Be, you know, be certain about it. And, you know, it will turn out in the correct way if we put the right mind to it, because the prophet would say the right mental attitude toward any promise will bring it to pass. Right. Well, but recognizing all of those and seeing all of those down through the Bible, and then coming down to the end time to talk about the prophet and the signs and the wonders and the things that, that you know, has taken place or did through the ministry. And then, you know, if that's all we can talk about, then, you know, I believe we're missing the theme of the whole thing. I thought all of that was to build up our faith into realizing who we are. All right? And then as I've emphasized now, a couple of messages, that Paul talks about these obtaining, you know, the position. But then turned around and says, they didn't attain. Well, that's, you know, that sounds kind of a little contradictory, but it's true. They did attain unto what God promised them for the day they were living in the time. All right? And then in doing that, see, that's a great faith builder for you and I, that we can look back and see they did attain. But then also to realize that there was something they didn't attain unto. You know? And to see that we would have something to do with the ending up or bringing them to a completion or perfection, not as we try to make them perfect, but as a completion or a finish of what they should have done. But to see, and I hope you follow that line, that as we ended up at the end this morning, through their unbelief, the mercy of God was extended to you and I. All right? Then, and the point was that if that brings mercy to you and I, why wouldn't we have mercy for others? All right? And in doing it, that we would have a part to do with this. You know, by them turning down, did you follow the thought? That whether you believe it or not, you just have to pray anyway, because I can't reveal it. But to know that they turned down the gospel, Israel. All right? And we accepted it. All right? What if we had not have accepted it? Where would we be? All right? But what if they have accepted it? Where would we be? All right? So then it's a wonderful opportunity for you and I to be able to understand the whole layout of the Bible and to see doing it, but see then that everything points to you and I. Because all before us could not be made perfect without you and I. Now, could not be made complete, could not be brought to an end of what they were supposed to have been brought. All right? And I don't have the wording, I don't have the education to express it, just my own thoughts. But when they turned down the gospel and the Gentiles received it, it put Israel in a blinded state. Right. All right? And when it did, then you and I would be able to run that into the prophet's message and study it. Just look. So you say, no. Israel, God didn't blind Israel. Brother Brown said, God put his hand over Israel's eyes. He blinded them. Why? Because he knew we would come in. Now, don't you think that God would have the ability to enter into a person and explain what he wanted to? Now, don't you believe God would have that ability? Right. I believe he could take a dog and make it do what he wanted it to do. Amen. All right? You know. But see, if you'll study on it, you'll find the prophet saying that when Jesus kept saying, Son of Man, I was just looking at it a moment ago, you know. He said Israel couldn't understand that. Because they couldn't comprehend, you know, why he would say, Son of Man. All right? And that was the secret that was hidden down through all of the ages and came out in the end time with this prophet. and probably 1947 when he first started, you know, that we have the records of the tapes that recorded, that he probably mentioned Son of Man then. You know, but do we understand it? Because he said that Israel was blinded because of him coming exactly the way the word said he would come. All right? So now, sure, there was a lot of people that blinded their own selves. This age where we're at, the Gentiles, the biggest portion of the people are blinded to the truth. Right? Because it came the way that it came. Right? We were talking about it last night in the Bible study. I know maybe my mind is all, I don't know. Maybe I'm just gone wacky studying the Word of God. But leave me alone. I'm happy. I may be wacky, but I'm happy. All right? We were talking about last night. What do you think about the 300 ministers who questioned Brother Branham about the water baptism? You remember? When he got through explaining it, they said, we want the tapes. We are going to get baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we want those tapes for the people. He said, not one minister. Now, I was expressing it to him last night. Do you think those 300 preachers went home and taught their people about water baptism? I don't think they did, you know. I don't think the water baptism was mentioned that way. If it was, it was mentioned in the point that we proved him wrong. We're going to stay with Father, Son, Holy Ghost. See, they were blinded. Blinded to the truth. Well, you know what that done to the people? Blinded the people. All right. And like I was telling them, it took a man with, like Brother Branham, with no education and things. And I know you've heard me say this hundreds of times. But when Brother Moat said, what do you believe about the Godhead? I said, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. He said, you're a Trinity like everybody else. I said, explain yourself, sir. He said, you're a father, you're a son, you're a human, but there's not three people of you. There's only one. We were talking about there in the scriptures where it said even the eternal Godhead could be understood by the things that you see. What about how simple Brother Branham could make it? Explaining a father, a son, and the Holy Ghost as a father, a human being, a person, and you being one. But because of our educated mind, you know what that done? That blinded people. Right? To the truth. What we've been taught is what's blinding us. Right. Israel had it figured out, as I said this morning. This group had it that way. This group had it that way. That group had it that way. And because he didn't come that way, they were blinded to the truth. But you know what? He came exactly the way the word said he would come. Now, is it true that according to Malachi 4, that we were promised in the last days a prophet would come? Is that true? You know? And you know what? By coming the way he come, people wouldn't have it. But if he'd have come as a great Billy Graham, Oral Roberts, great compromiser, they would have accepted it. But because of him being the way he was, it blinded the people. And they wouldn't have it. But you think about it, church. I got this message. I was going to preach it this evening, but we better stay with the comments and questions a little bit. But I wish you would think about it until next weekend. Lord willing. What's the greatest thing of sin? What's the greatest sin you could think of? I wish you would just put that down and think about it for a week. What is the greatest sin you could think of? When we know it's not drinking, gambling, smoking, running around with women, homosexuality, perverts. It's not that. Brother Dale, I've not sinned in 40 years, you know. But I just don't believe that. You're talking about that one God. I just don't believe it. Well, you're the biggest sinner there is. So think on those things. But think about what happened to Israel. And it blinded them by him coming the way he said he would come. Then wouldn't it end up in the same way to the Gentiles, by him saying the way he'd come, and he came that way, that it would blind again. Some are blinded willingly, all right, and some of natural Israel back there were blinded willingly, because even Gamaliel and Nicodemus, you know, Gamaliel would say, you better leave this alone. Right. If it be of God, you're fighting God. Right. If not, it'll come to aught, you know, naught. It'll come no good. Right. And you know what? What if we are that blind today? But what do you mean, Brother Dale? We study the message, we do. Why are there so many different doctrines from the one message? Well, don't you think that Brother so-and-so has a right to believe what he wants to? Sure, that's the Constitution says it. But the Bible don't. There's no scripture in the Bible that says it. There's one faith, one Lord, one baptism, one God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Right? But that's just the way he sees it. All right. I believe in, was asked the question about it. I believe in everybody. I don't believe everybody believe, you know, is identical. No, we sit down and talk. We're going to find a place that we don't agree. You know. But are we going to split and refuse to listen to the other person? If we do, we made a denomination. Because we denominated, we die. All right? But you see, blindness then is covered in a lot of ways. Some are willingly blind, willingly ignorant, the Bible says. But some are blinded because God done that. But get the point that it's not that God just blinds you. That's not, I mean, I don't look at it that way. He said, I'm going to come the way the Word says I'm going to come. You're going to have it figured out your way, and that's going to blind you. But said the Gentiles will accept it. And that will preserve you to a time that I'll come back to you. But he'll never marry Israel back as bride. I want any word you can show that in the Bible, the prophet's message. He won't marry them back as bride because they rejected that. And by not being bride, they won't be sonship. You know, they rejected sonship. But he gives them a place. I've studied the message for all these years, and even like the fifth seal Jew, the only thing I can find is one thing where Brother Brown said, they are given white robes under the seventh seal. You remember in the scripture where they're given white robes and told to wait a while? You know? And he said, under the seventh seal. Well, see, I don't know what that means. Do you? You know? But they are given. You and I are not given white robes. Our white robe is the baptism of the Holy Ghost that's given unto us as a new birth. But it's not there later. Foolish virgins are given eternal life one day. But they don't have it now. Yet they confess it. And they die believing it. Right? So then we're in a vast time and a vast doing. But I want to make just these few comments. And then, but have you ever thought about the promises made for this age? Do you realize if we are the end of all things, you know, we don't worry about time, do we? We're not concerned about when. We're concerned about what's taking place. You realize then that we're promised in this day. This is the greatest day that has ever been. Brother Randall said, if I stood before time and God asked me, where would you like to live? He said, it'd been good in certain ways, in certain times. But he said, let me live down here. But brother, there just ain't nothing going on. You know? I mean, nothing's going on. We don't see no signs and wonders. No wonder. My brother Brown said it wasn't meant for you. Wasn't that the way he said it? It wasn't meant for you. All right? But you see, we look at things in our own way. But yet, the promise is made for this age. If it was no more than to read Hebrews 11:40, according to my understanding of the English language, when you would read that, you'd say, God having provided some better thing for us, that they, without us, should not be made perfect. Well, you know what? That means everybody from here back. Is that English? Is that just reading? Well, no, it meant for so long here. And our salvation is tied to everybody in the world. Right? Then everybody's waiting on us. Well, the promises is down here then. I would have loved to live there when Jesus walked on the shores of Galilee, wouldn't you? Sure. But you know what? I'd have been just like everybody else. I'd have been blind as a bat. So would have you. Oh, no, I would have understood. Oh, yeah. No, you'd have been blind. You'd been on the wrong side. We would have been choosing Judas as the great guy. Right? Is that the way the prophet said? He would have been chosen over the other. But what about the promises of this day? I'm going to say that. And I want to read a couple of quotes. And then you get your questions or comments or whatever. Go ahead, brother, if you will, pull up number 3. But I told him I didn't know which way I was going this evening, so we'll go this way. Look at number 3 on your notes there, which is taken from paragraph 367 through 371 of the stature of a perfect man. And that's number 3 now that we're still on the conduct. I mean, the comments and questions, brother. Like I said, I got both stacks here, okay? You want to go all evening, we'll just stay here and we'll see the sun go down. Wouldn't do it, would it? But look what Brother Brown says. Now you get it? These people who died in here are depending and waiting on us. So this church has got to come to perfection in order to bring the resurrection. Now that kind of looks like it's dependent upon somebody reaching perfection, right? And look, he even goes back and they're sold under the altar waiting for this church to come to its perfection. That when Christ does come, he explains it getting smaller, doing how it works and how that it comes. But I'm just interested in the promises. Go to the next one. Number 4. This is taken. What was the Holy Ghost given for? Paragraph 51. They didn't underline. I didn't underline this for them, so I'll have to pick the spot. But when we need it, where are we at? What's he doing? He's pouring in his spirit. Then those who are resting out yonder in the grave are under the altar of God, as the scripture said, are crying, how long, how long, how much longer? God's waiting on me and you. The church is waiting on me and you. Adoption time. When God can pour into us his fullness, his power, his resurrection, that when the church and Christ become so close together, till Christ becomes visible among us and raises the dead, and we go into rapture. The promises for this hour. Promises to you and I. Look at number 5, which is, sirs, we would see Jesus. E13. We're living in the day that the gospel made many great promises for this day. Now, is those promises true? And if they are, then we should live by them. And if they're not true, we should get away from them and find out what is true. Now, for me to walk out here today and tell you, look how close it could be. I'm expecting in the last days a worldwide sweeping revival. Well, that's part truth. But yet, it's wrong. It's not true. Why? Because we're not promised a worldwide sweeping revival. Brother Run said that's where people miss it, looking at that, seeing the two witnesses to Israel, and thinking it's for us. No. But what is the promises for this day? I got a little message. I'll probably preach on it and get a little time. What about a revival? Oh, yeah. You can say, revival's over, Brother Dale. Brother Brown said that. He said, the United States turned down the gospel in 56. Revival's over. But then he'll turn around and say that the people has failed to see the awakening of the bride. See, then there can be a revival to the bride, which would be individuals. but no revival to the world. Right? And like I've told you ever since I came in this message, I've been in a revival. And I told you the other day, if you were to think about it, Brother Brown's one that said this. He said every time a revival went forth, he said insane asylums filled up. That's what he says. You checking? Well, you know they're kind of full right now. So there must be something going on. Right? Let it begin in me. All right? So let's find out whether it's true or not. We're to have a revival for ourselves and the message and the continuing. That's true. But a worldwide sweeping revival is not to the Gentiles. Now we know what truth is. Okay? Go on to the next one. Just the promises. The presence of God unrecognized. And look what he says. Paragraph 118. So many things. Look at this days, what he said would take place. Look at the promises that he made would take place this day. And then examine it of what is going on and see where we're at. And you see whether he's still in his word or not. They wanted to see the sign of Moses, the sign of David and all the different. But those things showed clearly, right? Roll on up just a little bit. What day they were living in, what day each one, Moses, David, whatever, was written in the Bible, right? And they seen their clear day because they seen it manifest, and they wrote it. What about you and I? He's doing the same thing right now. Search the scriptures, you who believe the Bible. What is supposed to take place right here before his coming? It was promised that the word for each age. Well, then we must have a word for this age. But have we recognized that the world is waiting on us? God is waiting on you and I. Right? God is waiting on somebody to realize who they are. Now, we'll never do that by trying to find out how goody-goody we can be. I love the way God talks. It's so wonderful when you really understand the way he's saying it. You know that Moses had a lot of failures, smiting the rocks and the different things. Have you ever read when he called Joshua to start his ministry? You ever read that? As I was with Moses, so I'll be with thee. I read that one day and I thought, what a God. He was simply saying, Joshua, I'm going to take you through. The failures of Moses never hindered the promise. Neither will your failures hinder the promise. Come on. That's where we're at. You know, you go out there right now and say, son, go down. It will. It's going to take a few hours. Son, stand still. No. Those are not for the day that we're living. Those were for the day that God used them. You and I have a promise in this day to take this message and bring forth the dead from the grave. That's right. Amen. Of course, now they've got it figured out. They got this about Brother Branham to do this. They got this about other ministers to come and do this. They got this about waiting on so-and-so to do this. They're waiting on this, that, or the other. Everybody's got it figured out. I'm not going to argue with you about you figuring out. I'm just going to say one thing for sure. The Bible doesn't say that we're waiting on Brother Branham to come back. I believe he will. Thank God for it. I've explained that over and over to you. He's got a 30, 40 days. He can preach all he wants to from the time of the resurrection. I have no problems with anybody that believes in all kind of doctrine like that. My problem is when you won't open your eyes and look at what's taking place. That's what we just read. Amen. To see what's going on. The Bible says, without us, they cannot be made perfect. The prophet said, God is waiting on you and I. Right? We set it on one thing of event to take place. We have narrowed that down to a wrong place, I think. But when we put it to the Word of God and believe that the world is waiting on you and I to realize who we are. All right. Let me give me one more that I didn't give them. Because I've quoted this a lot to you. But it's taken from, if they pick it up and put it up, they can get it. Page 15 of the Church Age book, The Revelation of Jesus Christ. You can start it by now. Remember this. So they're running in there. You can run it in. They beat me to it, don't they? And remember this. Christ in his true church is a continuation of the book of Acts. But the book of Revelation shows how the Antichrist spirit would come into the church and defile it, making it lukewarm, formal, and powerless. It exposes Satan, revealing his works. What's his works? Attempted destruction of God's people and the discrediting of God's word. Right down to the time he's cast into the lake of fire. He fights that. He cannot stand it. He knows that if the people get the true revelation of the true church and what she is, what she stands for, and that she can do the greater works. She will be an invincible army if they get a true revelation of the two spirits within the framework of the Christian church. And by God's spirit, discern and withstand the Antichrist spirit, Satan will be powerless before her, just like he was with the Lord Jesus. By him knowing who he was. But I just can't see that, Brother Dale, of how that we can be what we are. And we can do the greater works. Now there's messages all over the land on what the greater works are. But think about it. I thought that we believed that, as I've brought out in the last two or three messages, or a little, maybe for a long time, that when God wrote about Abraham, he never wrote about any of his problems. When he wrote about Sarah, he didn't write about any of his problems. I'm talking about in the New Testament through Paul. He said he staggered not. Well, then you say, we can never attain unto this statement here. Well, that means you can't attain. But if that statement's true, they may not be but one person. But somebody is going to stand in that place. And why can't I contend that I am that person? Right? So then everything is dependent upon whether or not somebody can take this word and walk right up to death and life at it and say, move on. I'm going on. We look, no, we can't do the greater works. Then you get hung up trying to figure out what greater works are. We know we can't do nothing greater than what he does. See? Come on, church. There's the 500 preachers, or 300 preachers that went home and taught their church not the correct form of water baptism in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, but taught them that Brother Branham was a false prophet. And they wound up to be blinded. You'll find there's the greatest sin is to say, I can't do it. But you know what most people justify that? You can't do it. Right? I don't see that in you. Well, do you ever see it in yourself? If you don't see it in somebody else, you got to have a way of saying that ain't right. You got to have some standard to judge by. Right? When you say, I don't see it, you got a standard to judge by. So you must be the standard. Like I've always said, there's no such thing as an atheist that don't believe in God. There's idiots. Because they believe they're greater than he is. Because if I say there's no God, I've got to be greater than he is. Or I wouldn't say there is no God. What about it? What are you expecting, Brother Dale? Just what the prophet said in one of the quotes. That Jesus Christ would become visible among us and raise the dead, and we go in the rapture. I don't see it. Well, do you mean it's not true? I've never been up in a spaceship went into Mars and things or anywhere else. Have you? Who was it talking about that the other day? It was Joe, I guess. You were talking about that they say that there's a sun out there on one of those solar systems out in there that, you know, I forgot how many years it would take a jet airplane. The thing is so big till it would take a jet airplane flying at top speed. He told how much it was, but it's like years to be able to fly around a sucker. And we think we're big. Well, I've never seen it. I don't believe it's out there. I've never been healed, so I don't believe healing is for us. You'll lay on your bed one of these days and you'll beg for somebody to try to convince you that there is a healing. I just pray it's not too late. My whole point of this whole series was aiming at this life part. All those great warriors of faith and what they done. And then Paul says, they didn't receive the promise. So there's something greater for you and I to bring them to their promise. And it's a simple matter. We just become what God said we would be. Is that hard? To become what he says we would become? Because if he said we would become it somewhere, he's going to make a way. Is that true? It's up to him to save us, because we can't save ourselves, right? Then it's up to him to keep his promise. But your problem is, see, we can hinder the promise. We can't stop it. We can hinder it. And then by doing that, we can prove we're not a part of it. Right? All right. Questions and answers, comments. Think on these things. Brother Gary, hang on a minute. We got the thing, so we want you on the thing too, where people can hear you. Maybe they got the same question. Right. Go ahead, brother.
You've mentioned many times in the past several sermons and today about they without us cannot be made perfect. Mm-hmm. Well, as you know, there is a teaching that believes that there is those Old Testament patriarchs that raised in that resurrection when Jesus resurrected there, that they did go on and receive the end of their promise, which was an eternal body. And there's mm-hmm. even quotes that Brother Branham made
sure.
that sound that that's what's being said. And could you spend just maybe a minute or two just going over those, the other side quotes and kind of bringing the truth of what you believe down through the middle mm-hmm. of all of it?
Mm-hmm. Like I said this morning, it's easy to think about the New Testament saints and kind of see how they're dependent upon us because we're all in a body. But then the things before, you know, the ones in the Old Testament. I heard a man just recently in a meeting that he was expressing just that point. He said that the blood of Jesus Christ made those Old Testament saints so perfect until they went right in the presence of God. Well, what is the presence of God? Mm-hmm. See, is it then that those Old Testament saints have totally gone on into immortality? If it is, you better rip out Hebrews 11:40. Because they wouldn't be waiting on us. And we wouldn't be waiting on them, so there wouldn't be nobody waiting on nothing. Right? I believe those Old Testament saints raised. I believe that. The ones that was in paradise. I believe paradise was taken up. I believe that. But where did they go? That's all I've ever asked. You can get a quote from Brother Branham. He went right into the presence of God. I believe that. You can get a quote where he said, open up your left everlasting gates. The King of Glory come in. And he goes right in and takes them right in. I believe that. All right. But where did they go? And how did they get to immortality? Because if they raised in glorified bodies, literal, physical, glorified bodies, they went into immortality, into resurrection. That's sensual. All right. Where did they go? When the Bible says that Jesus is the only one that has immortality, which no man can attain unto. All right. So the thought is the Old Testament saints was waiting on Jesus to make them perfect. Good. And one brother had it this way, and he said that in the church ages, they're waiting on us. And that sounds real good. You know. But the only question I've asked is, where did those Old Testament saints go? When Brother Branham went beyond the curtain of time, where did he go? Sixth dimension. Right? All right. He said they were there in their souls. Theophany. Sixth dimension. I forgot the wording he actually used. It was something like, where's Jesus? He said, you can't go where he's at. He said, because he's higher. Well, that's why I don't see that the Old Testament saints achieved a position that they could go to when even the people who had died in Christ were not allowed to go to that position. That they're there, their body's here. All right. I know that I'm facing a lot of questionable things, but I've been asked to state it, and I will. And if I'm wrong, then I can be helped, because I will tell you what I believe. But you'll sit there and sour up and won't tell me what you believe. But go tell everybody else. I don't agree with Brother Dale about that Old Testament saints. Well, why didn't you come tell me you didn't? Okay. But listen. When they came up, did they come up in glorified bodies? Brother Brown says they did. Right? Well, we'll say what he said. Well, okay, keep on saying what he said. You don't never hear the ones I gave the other day where that Brother Brown said, one day Adam will reach over and get Eve. Eve will reach over and get Abel. Abel will reach and get Seth. Brought it all the way down to Abraham and said, they'll raise up and go up. And then you won't go to the future home where Brother Branham says, those Old Testament saints will raise in the resurrection. And we will fall right in line and go up. Now, to keep you from going too far, don't try to bumble jumble that up and try to get it straightened out. I know what I'm talking about on this. I never preached it to you. But I do know one thing. That has to be put in the correct order. Because remember, his secret was fall right in line. It doesn't say what order it comes. You say, yeah, he said they raise. All right. You got Old Testament saints. What are you going to do with your fifth sealed Jew? Where do they come up? And 144,000 are not raised until after we're done in glory. Right? 3.5 years later. So the key is fall right in line. There will be a resurrection. And Brother Brown says, those in Christ, you know who he's talking about? Old Testament saints. But they weren't born again. No, they wasn't. But they were the Christ of their day. Put all the quotes together. Put all the message together. I've asked this simple question. Is Revelations 5 a literal group of people? Or is it a heavenly scene of not mortal people? Go to Revelations 5, you've got 24 elders, 12 apostles, 12 patriarchs. At the time that was written, John was one of the patriarchs and hadn't died yet. Right? So there'd have been 23 elders, right? And John would have said, when I get there, we'll make 24. He didn't say that. But I don't believe Revelation 5 is a corporal, mortal people. I'm going to give you the quote in a minute where it goes to, and then maybe it'll open our eyes. Revelation 5 is the Lamb that climbs upon the throne and sits down. Is that Revelation 5? Revelation 4, he sees the throne. He sees this, that. Revelation 5, he sees one climb upon the throne and sit down. You know that Brother Branham said? When those Old Testament saints entered into that city, now what city is he talking about? That's the quote. They entered into the city. Open up the everlasting gates that the King of Glory may go in, may come in. He said he went right down through the city. He said he went, Jesus, right up to the Father and stopped and said, Father, it's finished. I have completed this. Run the quote and see. He says, climb up on the throne and sit down. And I'll make your enemies your footstool. Where does he climb up on the throne and sit down? Chapter 5. Chapter 5. Chapter 5 is where he went to the throne. He's the lamb that takes the book. He wasn't a lamb. Right? You know, physical. It was Jesus Christ. I'm not going to argue with anybody about it, but I'm just going to state what I believe. I'm the pastor. I'm responsible for stating it. I believe those Old Testament saints, I have preached it to you, not to try to argue with nobody. I believe those Old Testament saints, when they died, their soul was not eternal. And that soul was put in paradise. Paradise would be called the bosom of Abraham, which is the faith of Abraham, provided by the faith of Abraham. That's Bible, right? Wasn't a place. It's just, you know. And Jesus had to go there and bring those people out. But he also went to hell to the souls that were in prison. But he didn't bring them out. But he brought the Old Testament saints out. I'll let you question it. Could it be that when they raised, that they raised in theophany? Right. Raised to a eternal soul? Amen. Making them capable of going to chapter 5? And being the 12 apostles and 12 patriarchs. And then it would be that they achieved a place. But yet their body's still in the ground. And one day, there'll be a resurrection. And they'll come up. That way, I don't have to backpedal, jump around and bypass quotes. I can take every one that is put there. Brother Brown said they raised in mortal bodies. I will remind you that he will call a theophany a mortal body. He will call a theophany a glorified body. Keep reading. He'll call those by those names. Yeah. But the only thing that I've asked you, simple question, if they raised back there, why did Paul spend Hebrews 11, 39 verses, talking of the Old Testament saints, and finishes it up in a 39th verse as to saying they never received the promise? And the 40th verse said, because they without us cannot be brought back to a completed stage of mortality. Because that's totally what he's talking about. He's not talking about the New Testament. I searched it and searched it. Brother Branham and I gave it to you on the statue of a perfect man that we read. It's the only time he connects the New Testament saints that I can find, you know, to that point of anywhere connected in Hebrews 11. Because Hebrews 11 was all Old Testament people. Right. Well, then why would he say that? Why wouldn't Paul say that they've done been made perfect? And a brother explained that, like I said, the Old Testament saints was made perfect by Jesus Christ. But now the New Testament people are waiting to be made perfect, complete, finished, because of a bride. I believe one thing. I don't believe those Old Testament saints raised in a mortal body to go to immortality. Because immortality is the position Jesus reached when he was raised from the dead. When he was raised from the dead, he stepped from mortal to immortality. And the Bible then is right that no man hath approached unto that. But Jesus Christ. If I'm wrong, I want you to show me. But I want you to show me the message, not, well, this is what I believe. Well, Brother Dale, you're just too dumb to read. Well, that may be true, but bring the quotes and let's read them. I've told you what I believe. Sure, they moved out of that place into another place, which would qualify them to be in Revelations 5 as the 24 elders. Because the New Testament saints at that time could be represented there as apostles. The Old Testament was represented as the patriarchs. And the Lamb had a book in his hand. He climbed up on the throne and sat down, amen, waiting until the life enemy to be destroyed, which is mortal dying. That's the promise for you and I. Amen. Somebody is going to be made immortal. Immortal, if I mispronounce it. They're going to be made eternal. Right. Body, spirit, and soul. Amen. And everybody else will fall right in line. Because we have achieved it. That's what I believe. Anybody else? You come in more comments, brother? Anybody else will say, hey, I don't agree with you. Well, explain it. But the problem is, like we were talking about last night, like the 300 preachers. Oh, yeah, we believe that. And I was relating to when Wade and I spoke in a minister's meeting about the Daniel 70 weeks. And for preachers, and we had proof of the drawings as being correct. We had two. One of them was a hand-drawn drawing signed by Brother Branham. And we had the one that I picked up in 68 in Jeffersonville, Indiana, as a drawing from what Brother Branham had drawn. And he says six or seven times in the message, refer back to the drawing if you got any question. You know what a big man in this message, you know what he done? He made his own drawing. And totally changed everything Brother Branham said. I'm at least not going to be that far off. Anybody else? Any comments, questions, thoughts? Be glad to answer any question or tell you. I don't. Sister Trudy. Croissant.
Okay, my question is for you to explain again, Acts 9:7 together with Acts 22:9. 9:7. Yeah, and 22:9.
And 22:9, that was one Brother Bob was on Wednesday.
Yes.
He got to answer that one. Ask him. I'm not. It looks like a total contradictory poem, because it says in the seventh verse of the 9 that they stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man. Right. Then they come over, and what is it, 22:9, and we're afraid, but they heard not the voice of him that spake to me. Okay. Sound like it's contradictory, don't it? Sounds contradictory. I wouldn't stand here at all if he had showed me that. I'd tell you, I don't know. But let's see. So let's read it. Stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man. All right. And over here it says, they heard not the voice of him that spake to me. That's the key.
That's easy.
Yeah. They heard a thunder, hearing a voice. They heard a thunder, they heard something happen, seeing no man. So he gets on over and he don't talk about the man, because they couldn't see the one. Now remember, it wasn't a man standing there.
Right.
It was a pillar of fire standing there. And they didn't see it. You remember? Moses saw the pillar of fire, but the children of Israel didn't see it.
Right?
Right. See? But a voice. One was a thunder. You know. Something happened that would have took. You remember into Jesus over there? Some said it thundered, but the voice spoke to him. See, those people never heard who's talking to Paul. Right? They never heard who was talking to Paul. They heard a blah, 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 some kind of a form. But Paul knew who was talking. Right? So the key is, you're not looking for the man, because they say they didn't see no man. Over here they don't mention it. But it's just talking about a voice. Well, see, you could sit here today, the whole congregation can hear my voice. Right? But what if there's only one person knows what I'm saying? Yeah. Right. Danny's the only one that knows what I say. You know what? He's the only one that heard my voice.
Right.
The others heard jangling words or sounds or symbols. Because the key over there is what? That what happened. But they heard not the voice of him that spake. They saw the light. Now, that's part of it. We'd like to back up to that. They were with me, saw indeed the light, and were afraid. It don't mention a light in the other, so we'll go back to pick up that little point, that they thought it was the sun shining down. But Paul, that light spoke to Paul. They couldn't understand that. But they seeing no man, verse 9, what was it? What was the other one? 9 and 7 and 9.
Mm-hmm. 9 and 7.
Speechless, hearing a voice and seeing no man. Mm-hmm. This over here says they saw a light. See, they saw no man. But it wasn't a man standing there.
Right.
It was the Lord Jesus. He said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. None of the others heard that. Right? You can hear the voice of God, as Brother Bob said there. I enjoyed it. You can hear it every day of your life and not know what's being said. You know, the Bible never did teach water baptism in Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. You know, the Bible never taught a Trinity. The voice of God is correct. But have we seen God, or are we looking for a man to try to help us, or looking to God? You understand, sis? One says they saw a light. The other doesn't mention a light because it mentions, you see, no man. Well, there was no man there. One says hearing a voice. The other one's talking. They didn't hear what was speaking to me. All right, so it's correct. They never heard what Paul heard. They heard a room, room, room. They heard that on the day when Jesus was standing there. But it had to be interpreted what was said. Okay? That confuse you? Sometimes I talk enough to confuse people.
I'm good.
Okay. Thanks. Brother, where's Brother Bob? Brother Dick.
Oh, me. Oh, my. I do things, and I talk to preachers and what have you, and I hope they bring things back to me, the reason why I talk to them and what have you. Sharing with something with brothers the other day, and he jumped up and I said, and he said he'd never seen that way. My question is about this scripture. It seems contrary one to the other and what have you like that, but is that all you see?
Yeah.
I don't know, I've been here since 84, something like that. I was around Atlanta, and this happened sometime before then. I was sitting in a warehouse rack at John Motors reading, and I was reading that scripture there, and I realized that to me, personal to me, that was the second, Jesus was showing Paul the second coming of himself. And I believe this is personal to me seeing that, I know who I am today.
Yeah.
I believe that people don't know who they are today. They're just a quote or something like that. But, you know, Paul held the clothes of the men that stoned Stephen.
Yeah.
He had no big experience there.
Right.
But when that happened, when that pillar of fire said, I'm Jesus whom thou persecuted, I believe he realized who Stephen was. And I didn't catch that till about 3 or 4 or 5 months ago, something like that. But I realized that Paul, on the road to Damascus with papers in his pocket to persecute those that was preaching Jesus Christ. And I believe that pillar of fire told him right there, those people that you're persecuting, that's me.
That's it.
And it's the baptism of the Holy Ghost, that's what I become.
Right.
And you say this and people say you're making yourself God and all that. Put that far as out of your mind as you can get. But a Christian today is a manifestation of the Lord Jesus Christ in human flesh.
Exactly.
And I explained, you know, when they had that band around there, what would Jesus do?
Mm-hmm.
That really means more to me today.
Yeah.
And people were putting it down and what have you, but that means more to me today.
Mm-hmm.
But when that pillar of fire, when I realized that's the baptism of the Holy Ghost, the second coming of Christ,
exactly.
The Lord Jesus in you, the hope of glory.
Right. That's right.
I hope and pray everybody sees that. And if they don't see it, I hope it comes to them, you know. But I've been sitting here all this time thinking about that. Mm-hmm. I say, when I hear preachers preach it, they'll say, I'm Jesus whom thou... I'm Jesus. Lord, who art thou? I'm Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
All right. I'm Jesus whom thou persecutest.
Right.
got the papers in the pocket for the people of that day.
Right.
So when you, in that song we sing, it's no longer I that live now, but Christ that liveth in me.
Right.
I thought when we started that, I thought that'd be the next national anthem.
Yeah.
People don't know who they are.
Right.
You know, I just want to say that. I hope it helps somebody.
Yeah.
You know, because I believe that.
Right.
I mean, to make me disbelieve that, there's some kind of catastrophe it'd have to happen.
Right. Yeah.
You know.
It would take away everything I believe.
Right.
Because I believe, and I've taught it, I believe the second coming of Jesus Christ started on the day of Pentecost.
Right.
In his bride.
That's
right. So he come first to redeem his bride. He comes a second time to catch her away. Third time with her.
Right.
So we are the part of his coming.
Amen.
And why can't we believe it?
That's it.
Who's next? Anybody else? Comments, questions, thoughts? Sister Frieda.
You have told us that we will be, I mean, maybe not literally me, I mean, but that we, the bride, will take this, it'll be this message
that goes to Israel.
Okay.
Won't be us to take it
over. The Bible says Moses, well, you know, Brother Branham told us it was Moses and Elijah.
Right. Right.
Will the people, Moses and Elijah, that takes this back to the Jews, will it be a present day person, two people with the spirit of Moses and Elijah, like Brother Branham had the spirit of Elijah?
Mm-hmm.
So that person could possibly be alive. I mean, could already be born and.
Yeah.
Okay.
Brother Branham will mention one time, as we go up, they come down. But that's still terminologies and words you use. I personally believe that it will not be a resurrection of Moses and Elijah, you know, in the form of that way. It will be the spirit of Moses and Elijah in the two witnesses, and they will take this message, because this message is the Bible.
Right.
And Brother Branham, in the seal book, seventh seal, I'm pretty sure, it's a little close to the end, he says there, he said, they'll tell them, look, you missed it.
Right.
You turned it down. But said, these people have become
that.
So it'll be, they got to tell them about us, because of how they're gonna tell them they rejected it. They got to tell them about a bride that becomes one, you know. So it'll be the Bible that goes to Israel through two witnesses. But I personally believe that it will be the spirit of Moses and Elijah through two men, and I have no problems with the statement you said. Could they be here now? If they don't just drop down out of the sky, they're evidently supposed to be here. But they will not be working, not saying they wouldn't be prophets, not saying they wouldn't have the ministry of prophets, but they're not in the limelight today. They're waiting on us to leave, because you can't have them here preaching about the Jews with us here preaching about the Jesus. Right? You can't have us here together. So we got to get out of here. And Brother Branham says that Israel will see God coming for his bride and think he's coming after them. That's a direct quote. They will see a bride walk off of this earth one day. How much of that will be seen, I don't know physically. I ain't concerned about it. I just believe somebody is going to become the Word.
Amen.
And that'll be seeing it. And what would be the difference in them literally seeing us on a TV screen, or the two witnesses walk out and say, the Gentiles has accepted this, and they've gone in a rapture. Now's your day.
Right.
You're going to have to be killed, as your brethren, the fifth seal Jew people, are going to kill. And said, it'll be over with pretty quick. They got a short time, right? Anybody else? They got to be two prophets. And one brother in this message believed that it was a Gentile bride and a Gentile prophet. Of course, he believed he was the prophet. What else would he say it that way? Right? I looked at him. I said, no way. Don't take Gentiles. He said, you don't believe it could be that way? I said, no, sir. I've got the quotes from the prophet that Israel won't receive a Gentile prophet. They will receive Jews, not Gentiles. Let's cut it off now because he done ended the tape, okay? All right, let's go right on into the communion. You got any more, let me know and we'll try to cover it. But I pray and hope that you see what I'm talking about. And, you know, and like I said, if I'm wrong, come and tell me I'm wrong. Don't tell everybody else I'm wrong. You just come tell me, you know, because that's the way it's supposed to be. I tell you what I believe. Why won't you tell me what you believe? All right, let's stand together. We'll go right on into the, but let's, we like to always do one thing I do because I like to give everybody a chance to get everything right. So let's just sing I Love Him as we prepare for the communion. And, you know, if you got anything wrong, get rid of it. Right. Get it out of the way. Let's do it, all right? I love you. I love you because he first loved me and purchased my salvation on Calvary. Sing it unto him and think about him. I love him. I love. Why do you love him? Because he first loved me and purchased my, brought it to me, give it to me, paid the price. On Calvary's tree. Father, we thank you for this day and the time, and we pray that what we've been said is worthy of being said, and we've just done the best we could do. And just help us, Lord, guide us as we go on into this communion part. Lord, as we partake of this, we ask you to make us all worthy because we're not worthy in ourselves to do anything. But you can make us worthy. You wrote about Abraham that he staggered not. So you could write about the little bride that she become your word. We love you and we thank you. We just ask you to forgive our sins, cleanse us from all unrighteousness. May the thoughts of our mind, the meditations of our heart, come to a place to be acceptable in thy sight. But until that time would maybe come, may they be wiped out by the blood of Jesus Christ. That they be not in your presence, that we may be perfect in you. As we read your word and take the communion, we pray you would bless and guide each one. In Jesus' name. Paul said, for I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, you do shew the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. I love this. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Wherefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, tarry one for another. And if any man hunger, let him eat at home, that you come not together unto condemnation. And the rest of what I said in order when I come. So let's just have a few moments of silent prayer, praying for one another. We love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. The Bible said he took bread and blessed it. Father, we thank you for this bread and we pray that you would just sanctify it to each one of our bodies, that as we're partakers of it, that we would remember that it's a symbol of the body of our Lord and Savior, not the physical, but a symbol. It's also a symbol of thy word, Lord, that was there that bled for each one of us. Sanctify the bread and the partakers that we may all be together as one in you, in Jesus' name. But we always think about Israel and their journey coming out. The last thing they done was had communion. They got together, they ate together, and then everything was set in order. And they left for the promised land. It would be a good thing, I believe, to be taken to communion and see the dead walk among us. A wonderful opportunity. Father, we thank you for this wine. It represents your blood. And Lord, we pray that you would just sanctify the wine and the partakers. And as we eat a little piece of bread and we drink the little bit of wine, that tomorrow it will be blood cells in our body, because it's a natural thing. And we know this is a natural thing, but it has the spiritual application that you shed your blood for each one of us, that your word could be revealed into our hearts. Bless us all together in you, in Jesus' name. Come morning, I walk by the river. I'll rest near the ever green tree. I'll carry my cross through the midnight. Come morning, there's glory for me. Sometimes I'm despised and rejected, and I question, oh Father, how long? Then I'll take one more look at Mount Calvary, and it gives me the strength to go on. Come morning, I'll walk by the river. I'll rest neath the evergreen tree. I'll carry my cross through the midnight. Come morning, there's glory for me. A solemn time a point of really sincere, that if we realize what this is and what's taking place, that it's not then no more a symbol. You know, it's a reality in our hearts and lives. And then we can just look right straight at it and say, well, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. It's for me. You made me worthy. You gave me the opportunity. Now, Lord, just come on the scene and make the rest of it manifest. Is that true? Let's all partake together. You can be seated for a moment while we're preparing and getting ready. Reading in John, the 13th chapter, verse 2. And supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he was come from God and went to God, he rises from supper and laid aside his garments and took a towel and girded himself. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with a towel wherewith he was girded. Then cometh he to Simon Peter, and Peter saith unto him, Lord, dost thou wash my feet? Jesus answered and said unto him, What I do thou knowest not now, but thou shalt know hereafter. Peter saith unto him, Thou shalt never wash my feet. Jesus answered him, If I wash thee not, thou hast no part with me. Simon Peter saith unto him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Jesus saith unto him, He that is washed needeth not save to wash his feet, but is clean every whit. And ye are clean, but not all. For he knew who should betray him, therefore said he, You are not all clean. So after he had washed their feet, and had taken his garments, and was set down again, he said unto them, Know you what I've done to you? You call me Master and Lord, and you say, Well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Verily, verily, I say unto you, The servant is not greater than his Lord, neither he that is sent greater than he that sent him. If you know these things, happy are ye if you do them. Let's stand together and be dismissed, and sisters can go downstairs for the foot washing. Lord Jesus, we thank you for all things, and we pray now that you'd bless us with your understanding and grace. Be with us, Lord, as the sisters go to the basement for the foot washing, and as we continue our here, Lord, and we pray that you would bless each and every one. Then take care of everybody on the highway. Give a safe journey, Lord, that we may, Lord, all be together as one in you is our desire. We love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You're dismissed.